My name is Katie Edwards, and thanks for joining in on the program here. We're talking about Toy Boom, and the reason we're talking about Toy Boom is because this exhibit is actually scheduled to close after Labor Day weekend. And so if you haven't seen it yet, feel free to go. You still have a little bit more time. And if you've already seen it, you still have a little more time to go see it again. And so this exhibit, I don't have a lot of time, but I have a lot to talk about. So I'm going to be like flying through. I'm already caffeinated here, and hopefully you have your morning beverage as well. And the reason this exhibit kind of came about is we were actually planning on doing a space exhibit on the 50th anniversary of the Apollo 11 moon landing, which was going to open in 2019 in our lobby. And so I was asked to do a toy exhibit that would also go in our lobby. And so I thought it would be kind of fun to kind of join those together and focus on toys of the baby boomer era. And so as I was doing more research, I was really interested on how much the space race really influenced toys during this period. And so I was curious about what other kind of events happened. There's so much that was happening during this time, the Vietnam War, the civil rights movement, and all this. And so I just wanted to see what other kind of big events influence something as innocent as toys. And so because I'm going through a lot of information, I wanted to include my email address here at the beginning, and it'll also be at the end. So if you have any questions and we can't get to your questions today, then feel free to email me. And if you're watching this later, feel free to email me any questions as well. So as I was doing research about this exhibit, what I found out was just, this was all about more. There was not just like a boom in child populations and the baby boomer, but there were more TVs. I believe it was, while nearly every household in America had a radio in 1950, only 10% had a television. And by 1960, that number had already risen to 90%. And television advertising also soared from 170 million in 1950 to nearly 2 billion in 1960. And so what I wanted to do in this exhibit was kind of showcase the role of television. And so when you go into the exhibit, you'll hear lots of jingles, lots of advertisements, and lots of really fun things like that. And so, another one of my like favorite aspects of this exhibit was including what I call toy stories. And so when I talk to a lot of boomers about their favorite toy memory from all over, boomers who grew up in North Carolina from all over the state, I really loved including those in the exhibit. And so Pamela Leathers talked about how her parents worked and her siblings and her received all these really fun toys during this period, from Mr. Potato Head, the Silly Putty, the Hula Hoop. So a lot of those toys you see in this exhibit. So it's all about abundance in this exhibit. So it's all about more. And so, and when I wanted visitors to come in and not just have like a fun experience in a toy exhibit, but I also wanted them to kind of think critically about toys and what, how our society kind of influences toys, something as innocent as toys. And just for instance, the other day I saw a commercial, with this like storytelling cube toy, and it kept emphasizing that there was no screens. So I think I said like two or three times there's no screens, which kind of shows how prevalent screens are in our society today. So hopefully visitors can come through and see some really fun toys, have a fun time, but just kind of take those experiences away. You know, what do toys teach us today? So here are some of the toys that I included that kind of pertain to television in some way. So in the top right, you have a Mr. Potato Head. And who knew they sold fake potatoes, but they do. And so we ordered one to kind of display the fun Mr. Potato Head kit from the early 1950s. And it is believed to be that the Mr. Potato Head was the first toy advertised on television in the early 1950s on the Jackie Gleason show. And then we have in the bottom left there, the Winky Dink kit. And a lot of people haven't heard of this toy, but it was actually based on a TV show called Winky Dink and You, which aired in the early 1950s on CBS Saturday mornings. And kids could send in 50 cents and receive this kit. And it came with this like vinyl plastic screen that you could stick to the TV via static electricity and then draw along with Winky on the show. And it's also considered the first interactive toy. And then of course we have Howdy Doody Marionette, which is based on the really popular Howdy Doody show. So I tried to come up with some sub themes in the exhibit. And one of the sub themes is all about kind of the zany toys, the most popular whimsical fad toy of that time. And it's like the world is now safe for democracy and zaniness. So it's all about movement and fun. And so we have the hula hoop, which was a really popular craze in the 1950s and 1958 and the late 50s. And it even inspired a song all about hula hoops. And of course the Frisbee, which also came out in the 1950s. And I love the fact that this early Frisbee actually kind of like calls out the flying saucer craze from Roswell from 1947. Another one of our boomers, Greg Richardson, talked about how he received a tricycle and kind of took it apart and rearranged the wheels and joked about how he created the first big wheel, which actually didn't come out to 1969. Of course, we have the Slinky and Slinky Dog. Slinky, I love Slinky because it was actually the inventor's wife, Betty James, who created that really fun jingle, which I will not try to sing for you right now. And I wanted to include Slinky Dog because Slinky Dog became repopularized from the Toy Story genre. And I wanted to show how he actually looks pretty different, but he was real. And then the Mousetrap game. And I remember playing this in the 80s, but I do not remember that setting up that contraption was that difficult, but it actually took like three of us to put this together, which was crazy. And then I wanted this exhibit to not just be a case of toys, but I really wanted the public to be able to come in, visitors to come in and kind of play no matter what your age was. And so we included a larger Twister game. And what's funny is that Twister was actually, a lot of toy stores didn't want to shelve it because they considered the game, put it on shelves because they considered the game to be a little too risque. And it took Johnny Carson to kind of demonstrate the toy with Ava Gabor on his talk show. And then like it flew off the shelves. And so we also have kind of a photo op back there of the mousetrap cage coming down the poles just for people to kind of pose behind just for fun. Here we have another one of the zany fad toys of the 60s, which is the Super Ball. And it was made with a material called Zectron, which I think is a fun like kind of sci-fi word. And I believe it was one of the zaniest fads of 1965, and it sold more than 7 million units in its first year. And I love that it has the atomic symbol on it because this is also kind of the atomic age. And, you know, with the Cuban Missile Crisis kind of hitting close to home in 1962, I definitely wanted to talk about this in the exhibit. And when I was originally planning for the exhibit, I wanted to include a mock-up of a bomb shelter in the exhibit. I thought it'd be kind of interesting. And when I talked to a lot of boomers, a lot of them said to me, you know, only wealthy people had bomb shelters. But there was all these duck and cover drills and whatnot during this time. But the bomb shelter was considered a little too grim for this exhibit. So the idea got quashed quickly. But one of my favorite toys that we had in the exhibit was the Gilbert Atomic Energy Lab, which came out in 1950. And it came with four different types of uranium ore, a cloud chamber, a Geiger counter. It sold for $50 in 1950, which would be over $500 today. And which was just a crazy amount of money. And so we actually borrowed this from the Strong Museum. And the Strong Museum was really great in this exhibit. They really loaned us a lot of great toys. Unfortunately, we had to send it back. So hopefully if you got a chance to see it earlier on, you did in the exhibit. So another one of our subgenres in the exhibit was all about kind of frontier visions. And so it was all about you know, the past of the Wild West and the future of space. You know, I talked to a lot of boomers and they talked about how much they love Western genre during this period. And so we have the Davy Crockett coonskin cap, which was a huge fad during this period. During the height of its fad, 5,000 were sold in a day. And then, of course, I wanted to include the Polly Crockett hat, which was based on Davy Crockett's first wife, and it was aimed at girls. It came in white fur and pink fur. Because this kind of topic was, you know, not North Carolina oriented, I wanted to include kind of North Carolina connections throughout the exhibit. And so first of all, we have one of the few North Carolina toy companies, which was, this one was called Flyback, and it was based out of High Point. And it they specialized in a lot of toys like rubber balls, yo-yos, and the paddle ball game, which I was never very good at. And because this is kind of like the Western area, we also included the one of the North Carolina connections is the Old Rebel show, which aired in Greensboro on Channel 2. And so here we have a photo of Old Rebel's sidekick, Picos Pete, and his dog, Troubles. And that aired from 1952 to 1976. And one of the things I learned researching this exhibit was how many TV Westerns came on during this period. In fact, between 1949 and the late 1960s, 100 different Westerns aired on primetime television. And so that's what I, you know, a lot of the boomers that I talked to really loved the Western genre. And so we have like, Bobby Harris told me that he grew up with his grandparents and he and a bunch of different kids in the area would just use tobacco sticks and pretend they were in the Wild West. And Faye Mitchell also said that she used a tobacco stick and became her trusted steed. Renee Edwards talked about receiving a different briar horse every Christmas. And Pamela Kaiser Barima talked about how she wanted to be one of the boys. And so she asked for a cap gun for Christmas and her mom gave her a little cowgirl skirt. And Robert Stone actually said that he, as you can see in the photo, got a Daisy Western, a Daisy Carbine Western gun and BB gun. And he can't believe he didn't get more in trouble when he got that. Another one of our frontiers is all about space. And so we have some fun photos from our museum photographer, Kent. And so we have, of course, the G.I. Joe and the capsule up there. But then Major Matt Mason was a really huge popular space toy line. I mean, there was so much space. Like I said earlier, space is the space station is the reason I kind of was inspired to do this exhibit. And the Major Matt Mason line came out in the 1966. And so and it was Mattel's kind of answer to Hasbro's G.I. Joe. And Steve Dixon, who grew up in Wilson County, talked about how much he loved this Major Matt Mason line. And it was a neat tidbit is that the Major Matt Mason accessories, like their space helmets and jetpacks, were actually initially based on NASA concept drawings. And so Steve remembered a lot of the Major Matt Mason toys actually were really popular before we even landed on the moon. And he was so inspired by this that he actually became an engineer later in life. Of course, we have some really fun robots in the exhibit, Rock'em Sock'em robots and some other really cool stuff. Charlie Harrell was another one of the boomers I talked to who talked about getting his robot commando for Christmas, as you can see in the picture. Another kind of subgenre that goes along with this was all about the Cold War. And I'm talking about kind of the spy toys and all about espionage. So you had a lot of the stuff like James Bond and The Man from U.N.C.L.E., The Avengers, Mission Impossible, Get Smart, I Spy, all these things and all these shows kind of inspired all these really fun spy toys. And we have several in the exhibit, like this James Bond car. Another one of our subgenres is all about kind of military and war toys. And so of course I included Battleship, the Tiger Joe tank. Bruce Edwards was another one of the boomers I talked to, and he talked about his love for the little green army men and how he and his siblings would divide them all out to make sure they all had equal soldiers. And G.I. Joe was one of the more iconic toys that came out during this period. And he was actually based on a World War II hero. And he, when he initially came out in 1964, he came out as a soldier, a sailor, a pilot, and a Marine with all a variety of clothing and accessories. And here we have on the right, one of the first African-American action figures that came out during this period, which came out in 1965. And what was interesting was the fact that because this was such a popular toy, but you know, in the late 1960s, a lot of television was airing a lot of this really grim Vietnam footage. And so sales of G.I. Joe declined by the late 1960s and he had to be kind of reimagined. G.I. Joe was reimagined as more of an adventurer and peacekeeper and less as a soldier. one of my favorite toys we had in the exhibit was the GI Nurse, and she came out in 1967, and she's super rare, and we unfortunately had to send her back to the collector as well. I just wanted to thank all the private donors who loaned us their toys. It really made the exhibit so much greater. So hopefully you got to see her if you've already been to the exhibit, but she came out in 1967 for 1 year, and it was Hasbro was trying to figure out how to target girls, like Mattel's Barbie was so popular, and but toy stores didn't know what to do with her. They didn't know if they should put her with other G.I. Joes or put her with dolls, and so she just didn't sell very well, and they decided to discontinue her after 1 year. So another one of our subgenres is all about creative toys. So after the launch of Sputnik in 1957, Americans were kind of questioning the methods of teaching, and traditional learning was keeping us competitive with the Soviet Union. So there was this push to make all these creative toys to help with more well-rounded kids. And so there was like the Etch-a-Sketch, Play-Doh, Lego, Spirograph, all those toys that really just kind of inspired creativity. And Omega Ray Wilson talked about how he received these art supplies from his uncle to help encourage his artistic talent. And so I knew at the very beginning that I really wanted to include a kind of larger than life light bright wall. And so I remember playing with that in the 80s and I loved it. And so I really thought it would be popular and fun for visitors to come and be able to, you know, draw something or write something in this really bright setting. Another one of the interactives I wanted to include, and we're talking about marketing earlier, how many, you know, commercials there were, was the Sears Wish Book. It was even popular in the 80s when I grew up as well. But a lot of the boomers I talked about how iconic the Wish Book was. And of course we couldn't put a real one in there, but I wanted something where visitors could come and flip through virtually just to see what toys were out there during that period, during the 1960s, and how much they cost. So now we get into all about gender. And so throughout this period, boys and girls were raised to kind of know their future roles in society. And so because it was such a child kind of dominated society, toy manufacturers really responded to by creating and marketing toys that catered to those future roles. And so here we have two kind of lab sets, chemistry sets, and we have on the left, the blue one for the boys and the pink one for the girls. And what's so interesting is that the pink version, the girls version, you could only be lab technicians. Girls couldn't be the full lead scientists, just lab technicians. Charlotte Fleming talked about how she really wanted a chemistry set for Christmas, and she asked her parents, and I guess she'd already dismantled like two transistor radios. And so her mom joked that if they got her a chemistry set, that she, who knows what she would blow up in the house. They called her the mad scientist, mad genius, which I thought was a really fun story. So a lot of these boy toys were kind of targeted around sports and around like cars and trains, like the Matchbox, Hot Wheels, Lino trains. And the girls' toys were more about homemaking and being pretty like mommy. And I remember watching the first Barbie commercial, and there's like a voice in the background thinking, "I'll make believe that I am you," as it's zooming in on a Barbie in a wedding dress, which isn't subliminal at all. But there was just so much about, you know, being a future homemaker and a future wife. And I'm not gonna lie, I'm sure the Easy Bake Oven was super fun, and I wish I had one growing up. Here we have a bunch of board games. There was, of course, Mystery Date, where girls could kind of play out their fantasy dates. And two other games that came out that I wanted to show during the 1960s was the What Shall I Be game. It was the exciting career game for boys and the exciting career game for girls. And so for boys, their career options included being an astronaut, being a surgeon, being, you know, a lawyer. And for girls, the options were way more limited, which was like being a nurse or being, being a nurse, being a flight attendant, being a teacher, which are, you know, great careers, but they just had more limited options. And so the game was re-released in the 1970s with way more options for girls, as well as more diversity in the game. Of course, we have the case of Barbies. Barbie was super popular when she came out in 1959. I think she sold $350,000 sold in the first year alone. And a lot of toy companies, doll companies, tried to compete with her and come out with similar dolls. One of the interactives we have is kind of a Toys, Where Are They Now? And we actually repurposed this interactive from our previous film exhibit. And it basically shows how toys have changed, several toys have changed throughout the years. And one of the biggest examples or most blatant examples is Barbie. That's her in 1959. And then here is the one on the right is a more recent Barbie. It shows way more inclusivity and just shows you how Barbie has changed. Another example is Lego, how Lego was really basic at the beginning with like very small basic kit with like three colors. And now you can build like the Colosseum in Rome. So there weren't a lot of major toy companies producing African-American dolls. There were some. Ideal Toy Company, this is the Sarah Lee doll on the left. And we actually have her in the exhibit borrowed from the Minnesota Historical Society. And she's like a beautiful doll, but there just weren't many companies producing African-American dolls during this period. And so Linda Edwards, one of the boomers I talked to, talked about how she grew up in the 60s and there were no Barbies that looked like her. So she would actually take white Barbies and paint them brown to resemble her more. And she did that for her friends as well, because during this period, there just weren't a lot of African-American dolls. And it wasn't until 1967 that the first Barbie, African-American Barbie came out, and it was the called her the Colored Francie. And here we have on the left, the Christie doll that came out in 1968 and the Julia doll, which came out in 1969, based on the popular show Julia starring Diane Carroll. And their hair was originally black, but it was, it's changed because of oxidization. So it's changed to red. But it kind of shows how the civil rights movement really changed a lot of the toy companies. They started producing more African-American dolls during this time, during the late 60s. And finally, we end the exhibit with a kind of an epilogue on changing toys. By the 1970s, birth rates had declined. And so toys were less about preparing for the future and more about escaping reality. So I wanted to kind of showcase kind of the rise of video games during the 70s. Kids were more into autonomous play, which is the trend that would continue on. So I wanted to include an Atari and a Home Pong and stuff. And I like this ad on the left because the whole exhibit talks about watching TV. And so the ad is don't watch TV night, play it. So it just kind of makes it full circle and changes. And that's it. So again, there's my email address. So if you think of any questions later and you want to ask, please send it to me.
Thank you so much, Ms. Edwards. That was really excellent and so interesting. I'm hoping I can go see the exhibit before it closes. We have time for a few questions, so don't forget to type any other ones that you have in the chat. The first one comes from Deanne, who asked, what do you know about the history of Silly Putty?
Silly Putty. I do know the history of Silly Putty, but I remember we have a great ad in it, and I'm trying to remember, you're putting me on the spot here. I tried so hard to find an original Silly Putty egg. Because I actually remember we have some great ads that show how Silly Putty was used to like copy comics. And I remember doing that as a kid and I could never find an original egg, but I know it came out during this period. I can't tell you the exact history off the top of my head right now, but I really did look for one for the exhibit.
Thank you. Do you have the date? I'm sorry, I'm not sure if Stacy also has the exact date that the exhibit closes. I know it's early September, but I don't have the date on hand.
It is, I can't remember the exact date. I know it closes right after Labor Day weekend. So that's in September, and whenever that is, it closes that next day, yeah.
Okay, thank you so much. The next question is from Lorraine, who asked if there are wooden tops in the exhibit.
Or wooden tops, is that what you said? There are not. Actually, you know what? We might have one. We have a case at the beginning that talks about really old toys and shows how toy, even the toy materials have changed. I can't recall. I think there might be a wooden yo-yo, but not a wooden top. I just wanted to talk about like the kind of how toys have changed over the years. And so you'll see like an old teddy bear, an old doll, and a wooden yo-yo, but not a wooden top.
Thank you. And the next question is from Connie, who asked if the museum collects toys. She has a Susie Smart doll.
Oh, okay. Yes, we do collect toys. We have a great toy collection. And so if you just want to send me an email with whatever you have, we can talk from there and figure out what to do next.
Thank you. And from Brenda Lazarus, did you include the Name That Tune game?
Name That Tune, no. I'm actually thinking about, I would love to do an exhibit down the road on board games, because there are so many really fun board games that came out during this period. And we have a really great board game collection that dates back from, you know, even the 1800s. And so I think that'd be really fun to do that down the road. And so I will definitely include the Name That Tune game in that exhibit.
Thank you. And then I have a question. I was wondering, when you were speaking with North Carolinians, how did the stories differ from people of different backgrounds, like specifically in terms of wealth? Were there any used?
Yes, so that was such an interesting part of the exhibit, because, you know, what I found was that there were so many connections. It didn't matter, you know, the background you came from. A lot of the boomers that I talked to just love the same types of toys and love the same things. And so there were some, you know, that talked about all these really fun toys that they received. And then there was a lot of boomers that talked about, well, we didn't have maybe have a lot of money, but we had to use our imagination. So, you know, you had the tobacco sticks that served as horses and guns for the Wild West, and just kids using their imagination and having fun during this period. And it connected like so many of the boomers. And that's what my goal was, to kind of show how a lot of these boomers, it didn't matter, you know, what part of North Carolina they're from, what they look like, they all have this shared connection.
Thank you. And then I know we heard quite a few different stories from your interview process and research process, but I wasn't sure if there were any others that maybe didn't make it into the presentation. Any other favorite stories you had?
I tried to include all, because the toy stories, the boomer stories were so important to me in this exhibit, I wanted to just at least touch on all of them. I don't know, like this was a really fun exhibit. It was also really like eye-opening for me, because I didn't really grow up during the period. So I had never really considered how much how much society, how much things that happen in our society really influence something like I said earlier, as innocent as toys. And so my hope is that, you know, we can, visitors who come in, young visitors who come in, can kind of go through and maybe learn something and kind of look at commercials today a little differently. Or maybe not, maybe they just have fun, but that's the kind of ultimate goal.
Thank you. And we have time for one more question. This one comes from Corey, who asked what your favorite toy was from the exhibit.
That's difficult.
Putting you on the spot.
That's really difficult, because I loved all of them. I think that the Atomic Energy Kit was probably my favorite, because it was just such a crazy toy. I mean, the fact that, you know, they were trying to teach kids to, you know, the safe side of atomic energy, and because it was such a big deal at the time, I think that was just, and it's such a rare toy, and so it was fun to have it. I don't know. They're all, I loved all the toys, but that to me kind of stuck out as one that I, you know, was really excited to get.
Thank you so much.
Thank you all. Thanks all for joining me on this morning, Wednesday morning, or Tuesday morning. And I really appreciate it. And thanks again. I hope you can go see the exhibit.